Are you frustrated from counting calories and still not getting the weight loss results that you want? Calorie counting and losing weight is unfortunately not as black and white as some people make it out to be. So today we're going to be diving into the science behind why calorie counting doesn't always work, why it is not a sustainable weight loss method, and what you can do instead. By the end of this video, you are going to have a clear science-based strategy on how to lose weight efficiently and reach your goals without having to count a calorie ever again. The traditional advice for weight loss has always been to eat less and move more. The idea is simple. If you burn more calories than you consume, you'll lose weight. But as I'm sure a lot of you are aware, this strategy isn't as straightforward as it might seem. And this is in part because it is quite literally impossible to accurately count calories in and calories out. First, let's talk about calories in. So it seems pretty straightforward, just measure, weigh, and track everything that you're eating. But the truth is that it is extremely difficult, if not impossible, to actually measure how many calories are in a particular food. And this is for several reasons. The first being that food labels can be misleading. They often underestimate the calorie count. In fact, nutrition labels are legally allowed to be off by 20%, either under or over. So if something says it's 200 calories on the label, this could actually be anywhere from 160 to 240 calories in reality. And this isn't done maliciously. Well, I mean, yes, a lot of processed food companies will go on the lower end of this range in order to make their products more appealing. But this 20% rule is in place in order to account for variance. Because even if you have two items that are made in exactly the same way, the calorie count isn't going to be exactly the same. But unfortunately for you, this also means that tracking the calories in any particular food is going to be extremely difficult. Imagine tracking your calories for the day and them actually being 20% higher than what you calculated. The second reason that it is very hard to track calories, and this also plays into why counting calories is not sustainable long term. And this is because there's also a large variance when you're eating out. When you eat out, you have less control over specific ingredients than when you're cooking at home. Restaurant meals can be calorie bombs, and even when nutritional information is provided, it's often an estimate. Some studies suggest that the calories in restaurant food can actually be 30% higher. But let's just say, by some miracle, you were able to calculate the exact calories in every single food you're eating, and you were able to do it accurately. The next barrier you're gonna face is that not all calories are absorbed equally. Factors like food preparation, gut bacteria, and individual metabolism can affect how many calories you actually absorb from your food. Now let's move on to talking about calories out, or the energy you burn. And this is where things get even trickier. There are four main factors that contribute to how much energy you burn throughout the day. The first factor is your basal metabolic rate, or BMR, which is the number of calories your body needs at rest. This varies based on factors like age, sex, weight, and muscle mass. Calculating this accurately is actually very tough. There are so many calculators online, and yes, these can be a good starting point, but other factors, such as whether you have restricted calories in the past, can actually lower your BMR. This is because when we restrict calories for a long period of time, our body notices. It makes adjustments and it slows down our output to conserve energy. This is why people who restrict their calories will eventually hit a plateau in their weight loss and only start seeing results again when they restrict calories further. Another factor for women is that BMR changes depending on where you are in your cycle. Now, the second factor is your activity level. How many calories you burn during exercise varies for so many reasons, including intensity, duration, and your physiology. And your activity level actually makes up only a very small percent of your total energy expenditure. It's a lot lower than a lot of people assume. And this is why you simply can't out-exercise a bad diet. I wish it were this simple. Third factor is your non-exercise activity. This includes little movements that you make throughout the day, including things like fidgeting, but also walking from your couch to your fridge. And this is hard to track for obvious reasons. And finally, we have the thermic effect of food. This is how much energy your body uses digesting particular foods. And this comes down to the type of nutrients you're eating. Protein requires the most energy to digest, so the net calories end up being lower than with carbohydrates or fat. 100 calories of protein is not going to impact your body the same way that 100 calories of carbohydrates will. Now, I know that all of this might sound extremely frustrating, but I promise you there's a solution. And the solution comes down to understanding and controlling insulin levels. Many people today have some degree of insulin resistance, where their bodies are less responsive to the hormone insulin. This makes it harder to lose weight because insulin is a fat storage hormone. When insulin levels are high, this signals our body that there is energy readily available, so fat burning gets put on hold. When insulin levels are low, this signals our body that there is no energy immediately available, and it starts to tap into our stored body fat. And this makes sense because insulin goes up when we eat. So after we've eaten and our insulin levels are high, the energy from the food is there, so yes, it makes sense. But when we haven't eaten for a long period of time, our insulin levels go down, and that's when we start burning fat for energy instead. However, here's the issue. When we're insulin resistant, our insulin levels stay high for longer than they should after we eat. So your body thinks there's energy available when there's really not, and fat burning gets put on hold. And when your body realizes that there actually isn't any energy readily available, this is when you're going to experience extreme hunger and cravings. So then you eat, and your insulin levels get bumped up even further. So if you are eating frequently, and if you are eating a lot of foods that are high in carbohydrates, this is what leads to chronic high insulin levels. And this makes it difficult for the body to burn fat. And therefore, if you want to burn body fat and you want to burn it more efficiently, you need to improve your insulin sensitivity. But how do we do this? We become insulin resistant when insulin levels stay high. So the solution is to do the opposite. We want to do things that bring our insulin levels down. However, this goes against what most people nowadays do. We are constantly eating and snacking. In the 1970s, it was common to only eat 3 meals a day with not much snacking in between. But today, most people eat 5 to 6 times a day. And this constant eating keeps insulin levels high. To lose weight, we need to improve insulin sensitivity without lowering our BMR. And fasting is a very effective strategy to do just that. When we haven't eaten for several hours, insulin levels are low. Intermittent fasting can reduce fasting insulin levels by 21 to 30%. Unlike long-term calorie restriction, which lowers your metabolic rate, fasting can actually increase it. And you don't need to be doing any extreme multi-day fasts to see these results. Start by eating all of your calories within a 12-hour window, allowing for a 12-hour fast overnight. For greater results, you can shorten your feeding window and extend your fasting window. But 12 hours is honestly very achievable for a lot of people, and it is very effective. The second thing you want to do is to eat less foods with a high insulin response. Here, I am mainly talking about carbohydrates. Carbohydrates trigger the highest insulin response, so we want to focus more on foods that are higher in protein and fat. Eat when you're hungry and stop when you're full. This may sound simple, but it's critical. And it's easier than you think if you are eating nutrient-dense foods. If you're eating these foods, your body will naturally regulate your hunger and energy levels more effectively. You want to center your meals around quality animal protein, at least 30 grams at every meal. And this is the amount of protein in the food and not the weight of the specific food. When you have most of your calories coming from protein and a lot from fat as well, it's very hard to overeat. And when you use this strategy, the calories you should be consuming, the calories you need to fuel your body, they're going to fall into place without you having to track them. Now, if you've been on a restrictive diet in the past, then your metabolic rate might have slowed down. So when you start this approach, you might gain a bit of weight initially as your metabolism works to speed up. The good news is that eating more actually speeds up your metabolism. But as your metabolic rate speeds up and your insulin sensitivity starts to improve, your weight will eventually stabilize, and then you're going to start to lose more fat. Please, when you're in this stage, avoid the temptation to restrict your calories. Once again, I'm going to repeat, this can be a short-term solution, but it's not sustainable long-term. In conclusion, counting calories is not an effective and sustainable weight loss method. It is impossible to accurately track how many calories you're taking in and how many are going out. Instead, focus on improving your insulin sensitivity by eating nutrient-dense foods, focusing on protein and fat, intermittent fasting, and not only is your health going to improve, but you're going to lose the weight you've been aiming for. Anyways, guys, let me know in the comment section down below if you currently count calories or macros. Has this approach worked for you? Is it working for you now? Has it worked for you in the past? Has it not? I love hearing from you guys in the comment section. So please let me know down below, and I will see you next time. Bye, guys.